Grace and peace to you, and welcome to worship for Sunday, February 27th, 2022, from Charleswood United Church in Winnipeg. My name is Michael Wilson. Behind the camera is Benjamin, and together we are pleased to offer you this time of prayer, praise, and a very special celebration in music. Charleswood United Church, I remind us, is on Treaty One land, the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, Cree, Oji Cree, and Dene people, and is the homeland of the Métis Nation. Our community is committed to a future of right relations and reconciliation. There is a local custom we have at Charleswood that we are observing this week. We call it Mardi Gras Sunday. I say it's a local custom because you are probably aware that Mardi Gras isn't a Sunday, it's a Tuesday. The word literally means Fat Tuesday. And historically, Mardi Gras took place the day before Ash Wednesday, the first day of Lent. The idea always was that on the day before the fasting of Lent was to begin, there would be a celebration in which all the fatty foods in the cupboard were used up. Of course, in many places, it became a time of great celebration of parades and festivals. Carnival is a word that many will associate with Mardi Gras. And the place where Carnival or Mardi Gras is most keenly observed and celebrated is New Orleans, the birthplace of jazz and the form of jazz music we call Dixieland. So it is that we honor all those who founded the Dixieland jazz genre. This strange combination of African-American and French Creole and Spanish all together. And we're giving this today's service some of that musical flavor. So I should stop talking and we should listen to some of that beautiful music. We're glad that you are with us. We hope you enjoy Mardi Gras Sunday with Charleswood. Let us worship God together.
Close to thee, dear Lord, let it be.
from the Gospel of Luke in chapter 9, beginning at verse 28. Let us listen for the Gospel of Christ. Now about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and went up on a mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish in Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two who stood with him. Just as they were leaving, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. And they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things that they had seen. Amen. And may God bless us with understanding of this God's gracious word.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it far. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there in the sweet.
Years ago, when I was teaching preaching at the university, I had a class in every course on orality. And in that class, I would ask the students to do a quick little exercise. I would give them a statement of fact, something that can't really be argued with it. But I would ask them to interpret it by the way they spoke the line. And by the way they spoke it, they could change it to be a positive statement or to be a negative statement. But the fact was the fact. Now I'm going to invite you to try this. And Benjamin, maybe I'll put you to the test too. Are you up to that?
I think I am.
So here's the line that the students would be given. It's minus 29, but it feels like minus 40. I try to say that as flatly as possible. Benjamin, you come and give the two options a try.
Okay. I should start with happy, best news ever.
It's the best news you've ever heard.
Okay. Well, it's minus 29, but it feels like minus 40.
Excellent.
Okay.
Now turn it around, and it's the worst thing imaginable.
Well, it's minus 29, but it feels like minus 40.
Great.
Dun, dun, dun.
Benjamin gets a passing grade, and I'm sure you will too.
I should say so.
The point of that exercise is to say that the meaning of a text can be altered by the way we speak it, and of course, it's altered by what it is we hear. I was thinking about this contrast when I decided just a few days ago to retell a story that many of you have heard before. It's a story that speaks to the moment in which we are living in a number of ways, and I'd like to not only repeat it, but take it a little deeper than I have in the past. It's a simple folk tale of a farmer who's out mending fence by the side of a road. And as he's working, a traveler passes by walking on that same road, coming from the town in the east and heading towards the town in the west. And as the traveler comes up to the farmer, he pauses and he says, "Excuse me, can I ask you a question?" And the farmer puts down his tools and pays attention and says, "Of course, what would you like to know?" The traveler says, "The town ahead, could you tell me what kind of people will I find there?" And the farmer says to the traveler, "Well, let me ask you a question. In the town that you just left, what kind of people did you find there?" The traveler says, "They were the worst kind of people. They were cold. They were unfriendly. I couldn't wait to leave." And the farmer says, "Well, I've got some bad news for you. In the next town up the road, you're going to find people just the same." And off the traveler went with his head bowed. A short time later, on that same road came a traveler in the same direction, stopped at the same farmer and asked, "Excuse me, I wonder if I could ask you a question." The farmer said, "Of course, what is it?" The traveler said, "I wonder if you could tell me what kind of people am I going to find in the next town?" The farmer said, "Well, let me ask you a question. What kind of people did you find in the town that you just left?" The traveler said, "Oh, they were the best sort of people. They were warm, they were friendly, accepting. It was a joy to meet them." And the farmer smiled and looked at the traveler and said, "Well, I've got great news for you. You're going to find the same sort of people in the next town down the road." Some would say that we have a choice about how we see the world. But I think it's important for us to kind of delve deeper into how is it that that ability to make that choice is formed, because a lot of us would experience that isn't so much of a choice, but just the way we are, as if we can never be changed. And lately, I've noticed a lot of people who were more like the first traveler, perhaps, than the second traveler. How do you see the world? Is it a sinister place, a dark world, a broken community? Are our leaders not to be trusted? Do conspiracies abound? Do we think that everyone is corrupt and we alone are right? Or do we see the world as essentially a good place, a wondrous and beautiful world, where people try their best, where all of us sometimes succeed and, of course, sometimes we fail, but we keep on trying, and for the most part, we are rewarded by placing our trust in others. Just because you see the world as a good place doesn't mean that you're foolishly optimistic or that every day is pie in the sky. Quite the opposite. The other day I was out for my early morning walk with the dog and I passed by a neighbor, someone I have lived down the street from for many years now. We don't know each other particularly well, but enough to say hi and how are you every time we cross paths. And so it was the other morning, hi, how are you, how are you? And he said to me, you know, I'm not doing well. And he listed three things. He said, this cold, this winter is unrelenting. And then the pandemic's been going on so long. And then I've just now learned about Ukraine, just feeling low. And I agreed with him about all of those things. My neighbor is not angry and resentful. He doesn't see the world as a sinister place, a dark world. In fact, the because he sees the world as a good place, that's why he is distraught by some of the things that he sees going on around him. How do we see the world? And if we see the world in a negative light, how can we change the way we see the world? Well, I think that way of changing our vision is near the heart of the story of the Transfiguration. It's a mysterious story. My aim here is not to take any of the mystery or wonder out of it. But in Luke 9, we hear that Jesus takes three disciples, Peter and James and John, the first disciples that he called, and he asks them to accompany him up a mountain in order to pray. I'm sure that Peter, James, and John thought this was a great privilege, and they were only too happy to do so. It was a long journey, of course, to walk up to a mountaintop, and they were very tired. But something unfolded there on top of the mountain in the eyes of Peter and James and John. Luke says that the appearance of Jesus was changed. They saw it, that his clothes became dazzling white. They beheld what was going on. And most astonishing of all, they saw him talking with Moses and Elijah, these great legends of their ancestry, the one who represents the law and the one who represents the prophets. And as they're trying to make sense of it, and Luke is honest enough to say Peter doesn't know what he's talking about, but they get to see something that they had not previously seen, had not previously imagined, a way in which they understood that Jesus, this human that they followed, this friend that they knew, was connected with the great legacy of their faith and of their heritage. And for their parts, we remember that Moses and Elijah were ones who had epiphanies, revelations, had their eyes opened on tops of mountains. Moses is the one who was on a mountaintop when he saw a bush that was on fire, but it was not consumed. And a voice came from that bush and said that he should take off his shoes, for he was standing on holy ground. Moses began to see that the ground around him, the earth itself, was holy. And he saw a new mission for himself to go back to Egypt and say to Pharaoh, "Let my people go." Moses' eyes were opened. He saw the world in a new way, a sacred way, a purposeful and meaningful way. In his time, Elijah was on the run, and he went up a mountain, and he sought to hide away from the world and from God. And a great wind passed by, and a great storm passed by, and a great fire passed by. But God was not in any of these. Elijah saw that God was in the still, small voice that spoke his name. Elijah saw that it was his call to speak truth to power, but not to claim any vanity for himself. Elijah saw the world in a new shape, in a new form, and he knew what he needed to do next. Peter and James and John on the Mount of Transfiguration have their eyes opened. They see the world in a more glorious way than they ever had seen it before. They saw that everything was all right with the world, even though the world was filled with trouble. And they continued to follow after the one who had called them from the seashore, the one who had called them to follow him into the city, where a new day was about to dawn. Peter, James, and John saw Jesus in a new light. They saw the world in a new way. And I would imagine that they saw something new in themselves. The Jewish rabbi and writer Harold Kushner said that religion is the eyes with which to see the world. And I invite you to share with others that it is because of your faith that you see the world in a certain way. And if you cannot capture that glimpse, I invite you to turn to Scripture and to listen to this heritage and to understand the ways of the Spirit, to seek out new ways of seeing that the glory of the world that is all around may be revealed to you. We leave part company one from the other this day, trusting that the world is a good place, a place of God's creation, of God's care, of God's mercy, and of God's love. And nothing can alter that vision. Amen.
The night draws near, and the day.
Let us unite our hearts and minds together in prayer. Let us pray. O God, we thank you for all that glorifies life. We praise you for the wonders of nature that display you are an artist with flair and creativity. We praise you for the wonders of the human being that show you are bright and imaginative. We praise you for the wonders of community that show how you desire people to be united in a common purpose. Your glory is revealed everywhere we look if we have only the eyes of faith. Bless us with an uncommon vision that we might know your glory. We pray as those who have Moses as an ancestor, for the call to heed your voice when it comes from an unlikely source, for the courage to speak against injustice, even at a personal cost, for the faith to trust that there is no obstacle through which you will not lead your people to freedom. We pray as those who have Elijah as an ancestor, for the wisdom to remain silent enough to hear the still small voice that speaks to us of right and wrong, for the tenacity to denounce corruption and power according to your edicts, for the capacity to be so filled with love as to speak the truth. We pray as those who have Jesus as an ancestor and as a companion, for the mercy to receive those who are broken, for the grace to welcome those who are outcast, for the love that makes compassion the work of our hearts and hands. We pray in this dire moment for your children in Ukraine. We pray for their safety, their courage, their comfort. We pray that you will work with those in power to oppose the aggression and violence that have been visited upon Ukraine this week. On the Mount of Transfiguration, your disciples beheld the fullness of your glory and were themselves changed into more fully the people you call us to be. Accept the prayers we offer in the same spirit, that by our prayer and the work to follow, we might grasp a glimpse of the glory you have in store for us. In the name of Jesus, who walks with us in valleys and lifts us to mountaintops, we pray together when we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll find way to lay home on God's celestial shore.
Shut up.
this with his eye and will follow till we die. We will understand it better by and by.
Thank you for joining us. We hope this time of worship has been an uplifting experience for you. If you'll forgive me, I want to do a little bit of housekeeping and make an announcement. This coming Tuesday, March the 1st at 7 p.m., is our annual meeting. For those of you who received the church emails, a link, because the meeting is going to be on Zoom, has been sent to you. And if you haven't received that email and you wish to join us on Zoom for the annual meeting, then please contact the church office before Tuesday at 4, and we will be more than happy to send that link to you. Please share with others that that meeting is coming up. The annual reports are available on our website. But that's not part company talking about church meetings. Let's have another taste of Dixieland music with the ensemble. And the most traditional, most favored of all Dixie songs, "Oh, When the Saints Go Marching In."